So after wonderful presentation, this is going to be basically a kind of what's happened to similar concept. Let's talk about, again, each, I only have 30 minutes to discuss a very broad topic in terms of surgical treatment for sleep apnea. So, prior to the 1980s, CPAP was, before CPAP was created, tracheostomy pretty much was the treatment of sleep apnea and some variety of modification of phalloplasty. So when CPAP came around, that was a revolutionary treatment, right? So suddenly patients would need to get any kind of invasive treatment with a tracheostomy, and they can actually sleep at night with just applying positive pressure through the airway. The problem is, though, that CPAP compliance is not exactly there. I don't know what your experience is like. In my experience, if I diagnose somebody with obstructive sleep apnea, I prescribe CPAP, you know, or PAP, auto PAP, or BiPAP. About 30 of those patients will put the PAP machine on, they have the best sleep of their life, and they keep using it. Then there's a third of patients, they're like, well, it's supposed to be good for me. I know it's supposed to be good for me. I'll try to use it, and I'll try to use it. The try different masks, they go through like, you know, behavioral medications and different therapy, and they try to use it. I mean, again, if you think about it, when you first put your glasses on, well, you're aware of them, but then the more you wear it, suddenly there's no longer your face. So similar to CPAP, it takes a little bit of time to get used to it. And some people eventually get used to it, but then even those patients, the compliance, the long-term compliance with it is not exactly there. And then there's a third population that just, no matter what, they just can't use. So that's basically, like, from my experience, and that means something that's similar to what's published in the literature. And so, yeah, so they're trying to look at those patients who cannot tolerate CPAP, they look for alternative treatment options, right? So, and the reasons for CPAP intolerance, well, everybody has their own reason, whether it's a nasal obstruction, whether it's claustrophobia, whether it's socially unacceptable, whether it's like high pressures that keep waking patients with a little weight throughout the night. I have a lot of patients who actually come in and say that, I'm trying to do CPAP, but I sleep so much better without it. So, again, it's a very different individual. So, if we think about the airway, it's pretty refined structure, right, for upper airway. Well, we're supposed to talk, swallow, breathe, and all kind of like interchangeably. So it's a complex structure. You have the ability to close your airway, prevent it from respiration when you swallow, and then open it up and take a deep breath. And if you think about collapsibility, like a lot of times we use starving resistor model, obstruction upstream creates more obstruction downstream, so relieving obstruction upstream potentially can relieve the obstruction downstream. If you think about like nasal airway, trachea, kind of the rigid structures, and then pharyngeal and epiglottal aorta that collapse apart. So if you relieve obstruction like upstream like by treating the nose, potentially that can make a difference in terms of collapsibility of the airway as well. And then modifications in the range of airway, the collapsible part, can also create some less potential resistance. So, again, it's not a perfect model, but that's something that just kind of like helps a little bit to think about the physiology of the airflow. So, as far as the collapsible part goes, palate and tongue seem to be the most common sites of the airway obstruction in that patients with obstructive sleep apnea. However, that's not the only part in the multiple level system. So the goal of the treatment is to address the airway obstruction in a targeted fashion. So the goal of surgery is to figure out what levels of obstruction occur and how we can intervene, and how is the best way to evaluate the airway and figure out what would be the best suited procedure for each individual person. So I think, you know, as the previous speaker alluded, the treatment has to be individualized. Just because we have a hammer, not everything is a nail, right? So everybody has their own unique anatomy or unique pathophysiology. And just because you can do robotic surgery, it doesn't always mean that that's the right treatment. So, but then the idea is basically that, well, so the failure of identifying individual sexual obstruction is potentially the factor why the results of surgery, sometimes not where we're going to be in the surgery phase. So here we can identify where the problem is. We can actually offer a variety of procedures. You know, there, since the budget had gone kind of long way since the tracheostomy before like 1980s, up to like now, we actually have more sophisticated five procedures for velopharynx, for oropharynx, for the basal tongues, and of course for the epiglottis. So the question now is like, how do we decide like, who will benefit from what type of surgery? And so Friedman tried to basically come up with the staging system to better understand, predict the outcomes of surgery. And it was a nice attempt for ulopalatoplasty. And what he showed that patients in with a stage one that have large tonsils and the palatal position of type 1 or 2 responded really well to ulopalatopharyngoplasty, right? So patients with large tonsils, 80% success rate when it comes to ulopalatopharyngoplasty. But majority of patients with sleep apnea, they really don't have large tonsils. And their freedom of palatal position is more like 3 and 4, where you can't really visualize the sterilopillar or the sterovirgin wall. And so those patients, if you offer them ulopalatopharyngoplasty, they have about 8% success rate when it comes to the surgery, surgical outcomes. So that probably like poor patient selection, that's probably what led to sort of the idea that people with ulopalatopharyngoplasty doesn't work. And meta-analysis that was published in Sleep in 2010 suggested that ulopalatopharyngoplasty should not be performed because it's just not effective. Well, again, if you look at what we've done, we basically offered it to everybody who walked through the door in the past. And of course, my response rate, as I mentioned to you, only the majority of patients actually don't have the proper anatomy when it comes to other people with sleep apnea. They don't have the anatomy that benefits from ulopalatopharyngoplasty. So that's the results of 33%. However, our European colleagues did their own study and actually did a controlled study, and they looked at two different centers. They looked at the outcomes of ulopalatopharyngoplasty, and they actually properly selected the patients. And so, the point of this is basically that there's still a role for ulopalatopharyngoplasty. You shouldn't just basically go by and say, oh, yeah, it doesn't work, nobody should get it. No, there's still patient population actually do benefit from this type of surgery, but again, it's all about patient selection. And probably, as you said, the patients, you can actually have significant reduction of apnea about the index by 60% to 60%. And the success rate is much, much better than doing nothing. And so, this publication is actually a little bit, there's fortunately, over time, the effectiveness of surgery kind of goes down. Again, whether it's because time goes by, then people age as well, their physiology changes, maybe they gain weight, maybe they have to be, it's not just about like, removing the tonsil. There's some underlying neurophysiological processes that also go on. But even with that, they still found that even though surgery costs money, even though like, the cure rate is not perfect, it's still performing ulopalatopharyngoplasty is still cost effective. For patients who cannot tolerate CPAP. So basically, surgery is still better than nothing, right? Because the cost of surgery is still, you know, justified in patients who cannot tolerate CPAP. So then we talk about, like, well, how do we further evaluate these patients who, like, who did that criteria, like, you know, about treatment position, like, on treatment stage, like, 1 or 2? So when we look at patients, we usually evaluate them with their weight. And so this is a patient who has severe sleep apnea, and this is the airway when they're awake. But then look what happens to the same airway when you put them to sleep and introduce the drug to sleep with the drug to sleep apnea. And in this case, you see like much more lateral pharyngeal collapse. And then look what happens to the epiglottis. As I mentioned to you before, this is something that cannot be appreciated on the way down. And this would be the reason why this patient just couldn't tolerate CPAP as well. Like this whole trap door of the epiglottis closing up the airway and the increase of pressure might actually exacerbate the problem. So based on this, just to have the difference between the patients are when they're awake and when they're asleep, it's kind of hard to just by physical exam in the office to offer patient surgical procedures. And so that's why the drug interest in the hospital was introduced, and the previous speakers talked about, you've got pretty much nice details of what the procedure entails. It's still, it's a data team, it's still drug induced, it's not natural, it's only monitoring patients during a very small portion of sleep. And if you think about it, patients think of different stages of sleep, right? They also sleep in a different position. And even if you look at the polysomnography, depending whether they're in the beginning of the night, towards the end of the night, their obstruction also changes, snoring pattern changes, and that's just something nuances that drug sleep endoscopy doesn't really allow us to evaluate. And so usually traditionally we look at the business diversification system that's used by most of sleep surgeons, and we just look at the dilopharynx, oropharynx, tongue base, and epiglottis. And we kind of like subjectively rate them based on, like, you know, a degree of obstruction, like whether it's partial or complete obstruction, and then the type of obstructions, anterior, posterior, lateral, and center. Some of those things, again, there's a lot of subjectivity to this. And also, I think, like, have to give credit to your anesthesiology colleagues, because I think it's somewhat just part of anesthesia. How do you get to patients to a certain level when you sort of mimic their natural sleep? Because if you give too much propofol, their airway starts to collapse because of propofol. If you don't give enough, then you don't really see what's happening with the patients during the obstruction. And then another thing is also, different people respond differently to propofol. I can't tell you, sometimes you just keep giving propofol, patients just don't fall asleep. Some patients start to cough as a result of propofol. Some people salivate a lot more. So even in individual case, like two different people can have very different response to different medications. So that's some of the challenge that they would be facing with drug induced endoscopy. But again, right now that's the best we have. Unless we kind of figure out some sort of chip that replaces the top of the nose and then send patients to live at home with this home study, and that like chip that kind of like monitors the normal kind of camera, the airway obstruction that they're sitting at home. And so that's invented, I think we're kind of stuck with doing something that's a little bit tougher. But since it's been introduced, a lot of colleagues started using it. And based on some of the data that's been published, it sounds like in cases of drug communication, surgical treatments, about 50% of cases were altered based on the findings of drug-induced sleep endoscopy. And most of the time, some additional surgery was based on findings that were associated with hypopharyngeal or laryngeal obstruction. However, even though, like, yes, sounds like it's a good idea, we need to turn to surgery, and drug-induced endoscopy give us, like, some more insight into the type of nature of neural obstruction, our French colleagues, they looked at their patients. And so what they did, interesting. So they designed the slow patients in office, they talked to them about the type of surgical treatments they're going to do, and then what they did before they proceeded with surgery, they did drug-induced endoscopy, and then they didn't change their plan, they proceeded with the original plan of surgical treatment. And what they found that whether they addressed all sites that were found or obstructed with the drug induced endoscopy or only like part of some of those sites, the outcomes were really not that much different. And so their conclusion was that some non-operated sites did not improve surgical efficacy, and some operating on both sites eventually not always guarantee the success of the surgery. So it's still up in the air. Should we really operate on nice findings, or should we still do like a stage surgery and kind of do like a more of an individualized approach that kind of like do one step at a time? So based on like, you know, some of the other evaluations of the airway, it was found that patients who have concentric collapse in the dilopharynx and the complete bulk obstruction of the base of the tongue, those are the patients who do not improve with surgical treatments, who are actually less likely to improve. So this is anterior collapse, posterior collapse of the dilopharynx, right? You can actually see that this through the wall is right there, and this is the anterior wall of the dilopharynx, so you have basically like my hair just collapses. This is a concentric collapse, it's more like a sphincter-like collapse, and patients with this type of airway seem to not do as well as surgical treatments. Well, interesting. So concerns and we go, oh, how can we fix that, right? And so our colleagues actually introduced the idea of expansion valve arthroplasty, where you actually try to change the nature of the airway obstruction. So you actually can change something like from concentric to more anterior-posterior, just expanding the airway and doing expansion valve arthroplasty. And here it basically entails taking the tonsils and taking the posterior pillar called the pharyngeus muscles and actually placing it, extending it to the cohort laterally and fixing it laterally, and that just kind of provides the expansion, the lateral expansion of the airway, so you get rid of that concentric collapse and change it to more anterior posterior collapse. And so what they looked at the outcomes of expansion valve arthroplasty, they actually found that it's a little bit more effective than just straightforward pupillo palatal arthroplasty. And this is some of the outcomes that were reported, but also note that a lot of the surgeries were done as part of the multi-level surgery. So some of that is might be just like the benefit of the multi-level surgery, so you can't really always attribute it to just expansion palatal arthroplasty. But again, a lot of our colleagues actually suggest that their pelvic expansion surgery, modification of the pelvic arthroplasty, could be actually more effective. And if you notice, currently, I didn't show you anything that involves removing the uvula. So, more modern techniques actually advocate more for preservation of uvula. Because uvula, as opposed to like common belief in the past, doesn't really seem to obstruct the airway as much. So it's a pretty small structure. You can trim it, but then there's still a function of the uvula in terms of like how to manage the secretions, and also like if you trim the uvula, there are certain languages that people have like some sort of pronunciation issues, having a hard time like saying like certain sounds that utilize the back of the palate. So I would suggest that you be kind of more mindful, and I usually advocate for functional surgery, just need to like be like you know kind of clean, like remove the tissues that don't have to be removed because that can potentially affect the function of the airway. So now let's talk further about the basal flux. That's not a level of obstruction that's been actually demonstrated to be a contributing factor to poor response to the airway. So here you just see like a bulky trunk pushes the airway towards the posterior pharynx and blocks the it makes it more narrow. And that actually probably also contributes to some of the positional obstruction. In this case, you can see pretty large wrinkled tonsils. And those are not even the base of thumb because you can see the base of thumb ends here, and then you have this liquid tissue that's plugging the airway. And here's another example of another patient. You can see how, again, base of thumb is right there. And this actually, believe it or not, those are wrinkled tonsils. Patient only had a tonsillectomy, like virginal tonsils removed. And you can see how they basically squeeze the airway and then plug the airway. And so you, in those cases, you can removing that blockage, like that liquid tissue, can be quite effective. And so that's where the transoral robotic surgery could be a good way to relieve some of the obstruction. And actually, it's interesting, with some of my head and neck surgery colleagues, they would say, well, when we operate a piece of tongue, like, next thing we know, like, oh, sleep apnea got resolved. And I think that's where, like, you know, we started, like, pioneering like, some of the, you know, using the utilization of transoral robotic surgery and the treatment of obstructive sleep apnea. So yes, so again, some of the cases that could be going to life, but that really need to get the basal fund resected, and just because you have a robot, well, probably not necessarily. So this is some of the data that's showing that with multi-level surgery, yes, your success rate improved potentially, but again, it's on the individual, it has to be geared towards the individual person. And based on the shared criteria, which again we try to lay using this type of definition of success, but what we use in this publication is a reduction of active outpatient by 20% and by 20 points and the reduction of 50%. So it can be still pretty, in some cases, quite successful. So, in general, also, when we talk about multi level surgery, and does it increase the risk of complications and morbidity? So one of the multi-institutional database analysis actually looked at 1,692 patients that have just dual palatoplasty lobe, Uoplastic invasive surgery and uoplastic invasive trauma as a part of bilateral surgery. And what they found is actually the rate of complications was slightly increased in patients with who had the bilateral surgery, like when the chances of potential bleeding. And again, there are sometimes like, you know, I don't know if they have those cases, but if patient bleeds, you know, the chances of them potentially dying is a little bit higher. I don't know how it is in Mexico, but in the United States, they don't usually get tracheostomy for the bilateral surgery, so here, but Italy, many times if they operate with the basic robotic surgery, they actually replace temporary tracheostomy. And again, multi-level surgery does increase the length of stay in the hospital. They still concluded that complication rate and that significant stay was not enough to advocate against the surgery. So their conclusion was that actually multi-level surgery is pretty safe and does not increase the risk of the complication. However, it is still associated with more possible costs. If I think about it, maximal advancement surgery is has been able to get pretty good reputation in terms of effectiveness. And our maxillofacial colleagues have published a lot of data that shows that people who have moderate severe sleep apnea after undergoing maxillofacial advancement surgery do quite well. Again, I would caution them to say that we don't know what the long-term effects are, because usually most of the reports are based on like 1 year follow-up, 6 days, etc. So I haven't seen the published data that shows this effectiveness of that surgery 2 years later. In my personal experience, I still see a lot of people who have no improvement with maxillofacial advancement surgery. So again, this doesn't work on everyone. My oral maxillofacial colleagues, they say, yeah, like, no, they see patients who don't do as well. And it's pretty invasive surgery in terms of like, you actually have to change lines, you have to break the maxilla and the jaw, you have to advance it, they actually have a pretty lengthy recovery to get back to normal function in terms of like eating disorder. And then it does change the appearance of the face too. So there's only so much advancement you can do before you start compromising the kinesthesis of the patient. But again, it's pretty, like, you know, so it's a good option. And I think people who have craniofacial abnormalities or structural abnormalities could be really good candidates for it. But again, that should be evaluated with case by case, like, you know, situation. So, and again, think about it. Not many people are willing to undergo this kind of drastic surgery. Because patient acceptance, despite a big, good shown results, is kind of low. So again, we kind of talked about the bodice. Previous speakers talked about this backdoor bodice, how we can potentially surgically address it. And this is another video, another type of obstruction. You can see how this patient has kind of lateral more pediatric bodice, not doing jaw thrust, the airway improves. So in this case, maybe hyoid suspension, maybe some sort of varicoplasty would actually improve patients' neural obstruction. And I think so just recently, we actually undervalued the role of the epiglottis in obstructive sleep apnea. We see that about 50% of patients who are able to tolerate CPAP have primarily epiglottic obstruction, as I mentioned before, they've had trapdoor epiglottis or neuromuscular issues that kind of cause some of that lifespan epiglottis could be contributing factors. And then also, if you think about it, when you treat snoring, and everybody's like, oh, let's fix the nose, let's fix the palate. If we treat the snoring, will go away. Well, not necessarily. 12% of patients have epiglottis as a primary source of snoring. So be aware of that. So why do people fail surgical treatment? Well, need to remove the tissue is not the most effective way, well, in every case, during sleep apnea. There's a lot of talk about like different typical problems that are associated with progression of sleep apnea, and the neuromuscular tone disorder, neurological disturbances being one of the underlying causes. And so, implantable neurostimulation devices have been introduced, and the idea has been around since the late 1990s, early 2000s, and now we actually have access to some of the neurostimulation technology. And I will talk about this later this morning. So if you, I guess, if I were to come up with a surgical algorithm of how to evaluate and proceed through patient evaluation and treatment, again, this is kind of my thinking. It's not necessarily something that everybody might agree with. But I think that people, we know that people with moderate to serious sleep apnea should be treated because there's enough health issues that are being associated and that show the economic cause of associated with sleep apnea. So people have to, I would never offer surgery as a first line of treatment. So I know in some countries actually, insurance companies do not cover like CPAP or appliances, but they will cover surgery. So, which is kind of like ironic because surgery is still surgery. It still comes with complications. It's still much more expensive than CPAP or appliances. So, I personally don't ever offer surgery as the first line of treatment to my patients. I usually try to get them to try CPAP, try other PAP because again, try different masks. I offer oral appliances. We talk about positional therapy. Of course, the weight loss. I actually send patients for medical weight loss evaluation because it's not just about calories in, calories out. There's some other underlying chronologic and physiology of the weight loss. Still trying to understand what will be the reason for that. So, but after patients have failed all non-surgical treatments, then we have to basically figure out what will work for this particular patient. So, look at the nasal obstruction, nasal hemorrhage, cranial facial anomalies. So, despite the fact that there's no evidence that nose actually, treating nose will cure sleep apnea, I think the role of the nose is still there. It is shown that if we treat the nose, we can actually improve compliance with CPAP, for example. Also, improve compliance with oral appliances. And also, like the ability to close the mouth and actually start breathing through the nose, a lot of times can cure sleep apnea. Because it's very interesting, like a lot of breathers, they definitely have like higher resistance to the airway. And sometimes just closing the mouth changes the airway anatomy during sleep. So I think like in some group of patients, if the nose is really obstructed there, especially if you're trying to get them to breathe better through the nose and comply with other treatments, could be very helpful. Because if you think about it, like, you know, can this nose be just part of the multi-modality treatment of sleep apnea? And one of the good examples, I guess, that was given is like, oh, when we treat high blood pressure, we don't just give one pill to everyone. We'll try the one with benzodiazepine combined treatment, right? So benzodiazepine combined style medications. So it's not just one type of treatment. So I think for sleep apnea, we need to start talking about it's not just CPAP, it's not just surgery, but it could be like multi combination of different treatments together, right? And those can be very helpful as an adjunctive treatment to, like, you know, with other even not surgical treatments. Tonsil hypertrophy, as I mentioned before, it works. 3+ tonsils, 4+ tonsils, I think there's no reason to keep those tonsils and try other treatment options before that. Craniofacial anomalies. If it's really like, you know, if you look at the craniofacial anomalies, then you can see that how the airway could change by improving their structure, and there's no harm at least on patients that have gone through the treatment. But then, like, the more challenging part becomes, like, well, what do we do with people who have normal anatomy, right? So, do we do drug-induced endoscopy? Do we offer them maximal endoscopy surgery, or do we straight go for multi-level surgery? Well, that's a million-dollar question. And I think there's no like real consensus of how to like know how to go from there. I do drug-induced endoscopy in a lot of cases. And the reason I do drug-induced endoscopy more nowadays is because I evaluate a lot of patients for hypoglossal nerve. And the company that I work with, that the implant that I use, they require drug-induced endoscopy prior to suggesting surgical treatment. But by basic drug-induced endoscopy, we can actually still get a little bit more insight into how the airway obstructs, whether there is like invasive fungal enlargement, whether it's anterior posterior or concentric collapse of the endopharynx, and if there is epiglottic collapse that will be addressed. And there is, again, if there, based on the drug-induced endoscopy findings, if you have like a large basal tongue that's needs or obstruction, you can consider basal tongue reduction, basal tongue surgery, plus minus tongue surgery, depending on what the findings are. If you have interpostero-glial obstruction, the base of the obstruction based on maximal medial advancement, hypoglossal nerve circulation can also be an option. If you have a concentric collapse, well, expansion multiplies in combination with having loss of nerve circulation or basal time reduction, or potentially considering maxillary advancement, and the pelvoplasty would be also considered. And then if you have a chronic collapse, that also can be introduced as part of the lower surgery. Yeah. That decision tree has to kind of like be coming from your own experience, your research is available, and also like you know, what the patient's wants and needs are. So I think it's a little bit more kind of a part of treating patients versus like you know, standard aesthetic recommendations. But based on the, like based on some of the evidence, that might be actually something to consider. And so, in conclusion, surgery for sleep apnea is still cost effective compared to no treatment. There are appropriate surgical procedures based on individual pathophysiology should be considered, and again, we need to figure out that what's a better way to evaluate those patients and provide the proper treatment. So, if you want to learn a little bit more about surgical sleep, or we actually do have the National Surgical Sleep Society that's specifically geared towards other neurologists who are interested in sleep surgery. And we are going to have a meeting, and me and my colleagues are hosting it in New York City next year. And so if you'd like to come, you're always welcome. And then also, our academy is in October in Atlanta. That's always a very good networking and educational meeting as well. And it's just not far away. So, anyway, any questions?